Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about air.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Over the centuries, we've come a long way in terms of understanding the composition of the things around us. Far beyond categorizing matter as earth, water, air, or fire, we now understand matter on the atomic and subatomic level. When it comes to the air around us, our ancestors could feel wind, and they knew we needed air to breathe, but that's about it. In this modern era, we know exactly what's in the air, from its primary constituents down to all the dozens of substances present in trace amounts. We know the structures of these substances, and we know how they interact with our bodies. And perhaps most miraculously, we know how to purify the air around us. We know how to pull certain components right out of the air, and we have built some remarkable devices that enable us to do this. Let's get a closer look at air purification as a process, as well as the machines that achieve this impressive task. As we mentioned, we have a solid understanding of the composition of air. So what's in there exactly? By far the most significant component, perhaps surprisingly, is nitrogen. Around 78% of the atmosphere is nitrogen, a diatomic molecule which is relatively inert. It enters and exits our lungs when we breathe, but generally doesn't really do anything. Then the next most abundant component is oxygen. That makes up about 21% of the atmosphere. And that's the stuff we actually breathe. We can't live for more than a few minutes without oxygen, making this the single most important substance to our survival. So we are already up to around 99%, which means that only 1% of the air around us is made up of substances other than nitrogen and oxygen. Most of that 1% is made up of argon, a monoatomic noble gas. This is also basically inert and doesn't do much. Then, making up the tiny fraction of a percent that remains, we have carbon dioxide, which is a greenhouse gas. We also have some more noble gases, helium, neon, and krypton, as well as a little methane and some hydrogen, the lightest gas there is. If we were to dip significantly below a concentration of one part per million, we could list some more, but let's just stop here. So that's pretty much what we can expect to find in an average sample of our atmosphere. However, we can certainly expect to find contaminants in the air as well. These are substances that are not naturally found in the air, but rather make their way into the air, often as the result of some kind of human activity. Sometimes this is not a big deal at all, and other times it can be a significant health risk. So let's talk about some common air contaminants. When discussing air contaminants, we can talk about two main types of objects. First, there are volatile organic compounds, abbreviated as VOCs. Contrary to popular belief, volatile does not have an inherently negative connotation. It does not mean bad. Volatile just refers to the tendency of a substance to go into the gas phase. So a highly volatile substance readily goes into the air, which can be dangerous if it is harmful because it presents the possibility of breathing it in, as opposed to a substance that remains a liquid or solid. Volatile organic compounds tend to include certain ingredients of household cleaning products, paint, and hygienic products like aerosols and sprays. The other type of air contaminant would be actual biological matter. As incredible as it seems, there are all kinds of living organisms and biological particles floating around in the air. This includes bacteria and viruses, mold spores, dust mites, allergens like pollen, and lots more. And of course, there is also your run-of-the-mill dust, which is just dirt tracked in from outside, mixed with soot, hair, and carpet fluff. Depending on the concentration and the duration of exposure, many of these contaminants we just listed can have a negative impact on your health, although each by a completely separate mechanism. And given that all of these things are far too small to be seen with our eyes, we can't exactly pick the bad ones out of the air with some tweezers. Fortunately, as resourceful as we are, we have learned how to purify the air by mechanical means. What is an air purifier and how does it work? let's examine the methods by which a typical air purifier can remove these contaminants, ensuring that we do not breathe them in. The simplest way a purifier achieves this is by particle size. The regular components of the atmosphere are teeny tiny molecules. The biological particles we listed, like viruses and mold spores and dust mites, are absolutely huge in comparison. So as air continuously passes through a purifier, it is relatively simple to trap large particles on a filter, while all the tiny molecules move through the many tiny pores. High-efficiency particulate arrestance filters can remove up to 99.97% of all particles larger than 0.3 micrometers in diameter. So most of this biological material will easily be filtered out as the air passes through. However, this does not help with small molecules. So for those volatile organic compounds we mentioned, we will need another strategy. One technique that is available involves a material called activated carbon. This is where we take chunks of carbon, usually in the form of charcoal, and expose it to high concentrations of oxygen. This results in the formation of an incredible number of pores on the surface of the material. And when air passes through this material, small molecules can get adsorbed into the pores. This is a common technique for removing pollutants from the air, and it specifically works on small molecules. So devices that use these two techniques in tandem can be quite effective in eliminating a wide array of contaminants. But it doesn't stop there. These basic techniques have been innovated substantially, and technology that has previously only been available in industrial products is now available in consumer products meant for home use. An example of such a product is the EnviroCleanse air purification system. Let's see how this product approaches the elimination of the aforementioned contaminants. To start, this system utilizes a two-stage filtration process with HEPA filtration for large particles and an adsorptive surface for small molecules. For an adsorptive surface, the EnviroCleanse utilizes a blend of high surface area metal oxides. This material is highly reactive, capable of what is referred to as destructive adsorption, by which it traps and destroys microbes like mold spores. Once adsorbed, a UVC lamp continuously shines ultraviolet light on any pathogens, which destroys their DNA, thus rendering them dead or inactivated. This adsorptive material is simultaneously effective against volatile organic compounds and adsorbs them irreversibly when oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur atoms from a variety of functional groups directly interact with the metal atoms in the oxide, which acts as a Lewis acid. This makes the material much more effective than activated carbon technology, which does not offer this type of chemisorption. To get more specific, this material is effective with formaldehyde, fragrances, pesticides, tobacco smoke, and many other types of small molecules. So essentially, the material in this filtration system is both more multifaceted and more powerful than pre-existing consumer technology. In addition, this system involves no release of byproducts into the atmosphere, so it is also supremely environmentally friendly. Contaminants remained bound to a cartridge that is replaced every 6 months, and all the air in a room can be exchanged several times per hour as it moves through the system. So the action is just as rapid as it is effective. It is absolutely incredible to think of how far we have come in the past 100 years or so. At the turn of the 20th century, we barely even knew that atoms and molecules existed. And now our understanding of the molecular world is so sophisticated that we have an intimate understanding of the composition of the invisible air around us and can even manipulate that composition at will, removing unwanted pathogens and odors, thereby making sure it is safe and pleasant to breathe. The fast-paced technological innovation of the 21st century is no less impressive, as the technology previously found in expensive industrial products tend to get implemented in affordable consumer products within a decade. With a little ingenuity and a dash of optimism, we can ensure that everyone will get to enjoy the purest air in the history of our planet for millennia to come. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.